in the present war, an urgent need arose for means of guiding planes safely home to their bases, both at night and in bad weather. A radar beacon was developed in Britain to meet this need. When strategically located, this beacon served as a geographical landmark identifiable by code. The beacon could be interrogated or triggered, and the code received only by radar. The early radar scopes were the Type L, and the coded responses appeared on their faces like this. Another beacon would send out a different coded response when interrogated. And the scope face in the plane would present a different indication, identifying another known landmark. As airborne equipment in general began to be developed at higher frequencies, the development of beacons was likewise carried on at higher frequencies. The first S-band microwave beacon developed at the Radiation Laboratory for permanent ground installation is called BGS and weighs about 800 pounds. Its chief components are the receiver, the discriminator, and the coder. Transmitter, modulator, and power supply. And the antenna. It is highly efficient and reliable equipment and completely automatic. Its reliable maximum range is 100 miles. The method of operation and use of a microwave beacon may now be briefly outlined. When a pilot is seeking a navigational fix or an aid for homing, the radar set is switched from search to beacon position. The radar signal from the plane then interrogates any beacon within range. The antenna of the beacon is equally sensitive to radar signals from all directions. From 0 to 360 degrees in azimuth and 8 degrees in elevation. The signal passes from the antenna to the receiver, which will admit signals from airborne sets in any direction if they are transmitted on a frequency within the standard scatter band. The discriminator discriminates against unwanted signals. It accepts only signals from airborne sets operating on beacon position. In other words, only a legitimate query will be answered. Search signals will not be answered. When a beacon signal has been accepted, the coder prepares a reply that will identify for the pilot the particular beacon receiving the interrogation. After passing through a modulator, transmitter, and transmitter tuner, the signal is returned as a specific code for a specific geographical position. This signal can be very strong, as it is transmitted directly and not reflected, as are radar signals. The method of coding in range permits a total of about 50 codes. The PPI type of scope presents this as a plan rather than as a pulsation, as was seen on the early British sets. Range coding appears as a series of 3 to 6 short dashes or arcs, variously spaced to cover up to 10 miles in range. This particular code is 2 space 2 space 2, the code of the beacon at Deer Island in Boston Harbor. Now, the coded signal of the beacon at Quonset, Rhode Island can be seen also. Its code is 2 space 1. The range to the beacon is read radially to the closest arc of the code. The center points of the arcs line up to give the azimuth position of the beacon. Here is a chart of several of the Atlantic Coast beacons with their locations and code identification shown. There are many uses for beacons, but their principal use will probably continue to be as a navigational aid and as a means of homing. A single plane saved by a beacon pays for the installation of that beacon many times. Congratulations from the Colonel and everyone else. Your squawker saved plane lost at sea in ice storm. No visibility, no radio, no navigation, only you. In the development of beacons, the fact that this is a war of movement has not been forgotten. The battle locale and the battle lines are constantly shifting. To meet the needs of a war of movement, a highly portable, lightweight beacon that is easy to operate was early in service use. The first sets of British origin were known as Eureka and were operated at low frequencies in the P-band against special radar interrogators called Rebecca. Eureka was particularly useful as a homing device. And more specifically, in such maneuvers as landing supplies or reinforcements to advance positions established by paratroops. As the frequency on which these sets operate began to suffer jamming by the enemy, and as airborne equipment was being produced at much higher frequencies, BUPS, an experimental, ultra-portable beacon on the S-band, was developed by the personnel of the radiation laboratory. It is far lighter in weight than previous microwave beacons and has the advantage over Eureka of the improved presentation of microwave scopes such as the PPI and B-type. This scene shows the battery model of BUPS being unloaded from an experimental truck. This experimental battery-operated BUPS, weighing 55 pounds, is contained in two boxes, one of which is the battery case and one which contains the beacon proper. The controls of the battery BUPS include the code switch, the power and operating switch, the tuning control, and jacks for the transmitting and receiving antenna cables. There is, in addition, a plug for the battery power cable and a tuning eye. If we remove the cover from the BUPS, we see the internal construction of this experimental unit. This is the underside of the chassis, and this is the top. The receiver and encoder tubes are on the strip on the left, and the transmitter and power supply on the right. The tactical uses of BUPS are still being explored. Some of the proposed uses will be outlined here. Some of these have already undergone tactical trials, while others are yet to be attempted. One use of BUPS is for the demarcation of tactically important points along a front line. Single pips are used as the code for each beacon. Here, close support bombers, if equipped with radar, could receive up-to-date information on the disposition of friendly forces as they fly over the front line on missions against the enemy. Another use of BUPS is for designating targets to supporting bombers. In this use, the BUPS units are set up to constitute an arrow pointing to a target, which is a predetermined distance beyond the last beacon. By flying over the course outlined by the beacons, the bomber can drop his bombs blind on a target, which may not be visible by radar. The AC model of BUPS is designed to operate from 50 to 2400 cycles and thus can be installed in aircraft using a shorter, lower gain antenna. Since a similar airborne S-band beacon previously developed has been called Rosebud, The BUPS so installed in aircraft are known as rose BUPS. A considerable variety of uses for rose BUPS has been advanced. One use is that which is known as the rooster operation. In this operation, an aircraft on a search mission, which has found its objective, turns on its rose BUP so that radar-equipped friendly planes in the vicinity may home upon it. Night fighters equipped with SCR-720 can carry out offensive or defensive sweeps in a formation of planes spaced 20 to 30 miles apart if the planes are equipped with rose BUPS and thus visible to each other's radar. In the field of ground control of aircraft, rose BUD or rose BUPS can play an important role. Night or day interceptions are considerably facilitated by the extension of range afforded by rose BUPS with any S-band ground radar used for control purposes. With SCR 615, 582, 584, MEW, V-beam, SM, SG, SP, GCA, and etc., the range in a rose BUPS equipped airplane is extended to the radar horizon. The increased facility of GCI operation is apparent. Interceptions can be directed from the ground at distances as great as the enemy planes can be seen. In general, this may amount to a range extension by a factor of two or more. Another application is in the ground control of close support blind bombing by ground radars of high precision, such as the SCR-584. Here a plane equipped with rose BUPS can be placed over its target by radio instructions. The use of rose BUPS increases range and permits tuning out of ground returns. The MEW can be similarly used at greater ranges and with a considerably greater traffic capacity. The possibility of using rose BUPS for solving the GCA problem of selecting one plane rapidly from the large number which may be near an airport has been considered. Rose BUPS gives almost instantaneous identification of any particular plane as soon as it is switched on. Several applications of BUPS in naval and amphibious operations are possible. Landing craft equipped with BUPS can be identified and guided by radio instructions from ships equipped with SG, SM, or any other S-band radar. BUPS can be used as a shore bombardment beacon for directing fire from ships equipped with FH fire control radar. In this application, tests on Tuft, a similar equipment on another frequency, show that accurate fire on land targets which do not give a distinctive radar return can be commenced on the first salvo by directing the fire in accordance with instructions from an observer stationed with the beacon. The following scenes were taken at Florida during extensive field trials of the use of BUPS for homing and for beam approach. We are now going to illustrate the use of BUPS for homing aircraft dropping supplies to ground troops. BUPS can be carried by one man, but here we see it being transported by two. One man carries the beacon and battery cases, and the other carries the antenna and cables. The battery-operated BUPS is to be set up at a point on the beach. The total time required for setting up a BUPS is approximately 2 to 3 minutes. Its average operating time without recharging is 8 to 10 hours at ordinary temperatures. Here we see the antenna tripod being erected and the receiving and transmitting antenna cables being plugged in. The BUPS is now turned on the standby position where it is ready to use at a moment's notice but is not actually transmitting. The operation is checked by turning momentarily to the position marked test. Meanwhile, a B-25 equipped with an SCR-717B radar is making ready to take off. This is the plane which is scheduled to locate and simulate resupplying forward troops which are equipped with the BUPS. The plane takes off at a predetermined hour. We can see the radome in its retracted position beneath the fuselage. The radar operator in the B-25 turns on his 717B and checks its operation by observing the beacon at his home airport. Here we see the beacon at his home base, which is directly astern at a range of approximately 8 miles. He uses the usual drift computer to direct the pilot on the course to be taken and checks his position on the map. The radar operator has now switched to search, and we see a picture of the coastline over which the plane is passing. The radar is used for navigation during those portions of the journey when the plane is too far from its own base or its destination to see its home beacon or the beacon at its destination. The operator checks his position by means of the radar. The beacon operator looks at his watch and sees that the time has come to turn on the beacon. This time has been prearranged. He turns the control switch from standby to test, and then checks the transmitter frequency to see that it is in tune. The transmitter frequency is indicated as correct when the magic eye shows complete closure. The time is now 14:05, the scheduled time for turning on the beacon, and the operator now switches from the position marked test to the normal operating position. The radar operator now consults his watch, finding it is time for the beacon to be turned on, and therefore switches from search to beacon. The beacon is picked up at approximately 45 nautical miles. The 717 has a reliable range on BUPS of 35 to 50 miles, and has on occasion seen it at 100 miles. Since the range is now less than 50 miles, the operator switches from the 100-mile range to the 50-mile range. The beacon shows the prearranged code, 2-1. Having previously determined the wind, the radar operator now directs the pilot to change course in such a way as to bring the ground track of the plane in line with the beacon. The operator turns on the range marks to get an accurate reading in range, which is 28 miles. Meanwhile, the beacon operator consults his watch and finds the prearranged time to change the code has arrived. The change of code during the flight has the tactical value of adding an element of security to the operation, since it makes more difficult the possible use of beacons captured by the enemy as a decoy. The radar operator, seeing the change of code, consults his watch and finds that it has occurred at the prearranged time. He tells the pilot that everything is all right and fixes his attention on the screen to direct the final homing. The pilot begins to lose altitude. The range of the beacon is now 7 miles, and the beacon is dead ahead. The indicator is switched from the 20 to the 10-mile range. The final stages of the approach have now been reached, and the radar operator gives the pilot last-minute instructions as to the course, and the rest of the crew instructions to prepare for dropping supplies. The range is now about 2 miles. The operator gives final instructions. The beacon operator sees the supplies being dropped, and one man hurries off to receive them. Another use for BUPS covered at the Florida trials is a beam approach system for guiding aircraft to landings. Two beacons are used, one on each end of the runway. By using single pips for the code of each beacon, the ends of the runway are marked on the radar screen. The radar operator can thus visualize the runway and direct the pilot how to fly to approach the runway properly. Intended for this use in poor visibility, BUPS will permit bringing planes in below a 200-foot ceiling with a visibility of 1/4 mile. Here is a BUPS set up at one end of the runway, and we see the operator at an SCR-300 portable communications set. Here is the BUPS at the other end of the runway. The portable communication sets, while extremely useful in field trials, are not essential to the beam approach operation. The aircraft with which the beam approach test will be made is an AT-11 equipped with ASG. The pilot's actions are directed by the radar operator. This is not a hooded approach. However, the pilot will follow the radar operator's instructions until told to take over for the actual landing. The radar operator makes the usual tuning adjustments on the ASG-3 while still at a considerable distance from the runway. In order to get more continuous information, sector scan is used. Each beacon uses a one pip code, and the position of the code pip thus indicates the beginning and end of the runway. As we see it here, the runway is about 7 miles away. The relative angular displacement of the two pips shows that the plane is not in line with the runway. The runway is now about 45 degrees to the right. The gain control is adjusted. On the ASG-3, sector scanning can be obtained only by manually reversing the spinner direction. We now listen in as the radar operator takes over and directs the plane into the runway.
Make a needle width, 45 degree turn to the right. Hold this course. The range is 4 miles. Go 5 degrees right.
The range is now switched from the 20 to the 5 mile scan.
Your range is now 3 miles. Your range is 2 miles. Hold this course. Go 5 degrees right. Range is 1.25 miles. Course okay. Range is 1 mile. Range is 1/2 mile. Range 1/4 mile. Runway dead ahead. Take over.
The pilot, who has been flying on instruments up to this time, now looks out and does the rest of the landing visually. The actual landing has not been blind. foregoing uses of BUPS are not intended to be taken as exhaustive. It will undoubtedly happen that imaginative commanders will devise new and as yet unthought of applications of these lightweight beacons as they become available for service use. Preliminary service models of BUPS in small quantities were available during the summer of 1944. The tactical uses envisaged for BUPS will undoubtedly apply as well to BUPX, an equivalent ultra-portable X-band beacon, research on which is now in progress at the Radiation Laboratory. This beacon will permit similar tactical applications with X-band radars.